For Rawls, this is John Rawls, his theory of justice, he's falling in the tradition of social contract theory. Now, social contract theory is a theory of morality. It's trying to explain what makes something morally right, what makes something morally wrong, where do you get your moral obligations? And the idea here is that just as we make contracts with one another to create obligations legally, there is some kind of more basic idea here for how morality works, or at least there's a really good analogy to it. So it's going to say basically that moral principles are very similar to the laws that govern society, but there's a huge difference. Moral principles are not tied to your culture. Your moral principles are not tied to what your society happens to agree to. Instead, it's tied to ideal rational agents in ideal societies. These are going to be people who make the best decisions with the best information available to them and have the opportunity to make a society that is not utopian, but at least ideal, the best you could have. So, critical for understanding social contract theory is that it's not saying morality is just the law. Instead, there's a legal slash moral distinction. That is that laws and morality don't overlap 100% because this just means that some things that are illegal can still be morally permissible. And some things that are morally impermissible might still be legal. There's not a 100% overlap. To kind of visualize this easier, consider this Venn diagram, or maybe it's closer to an Euler diagram, but the idea here is you can see that there's in one circle all the things that are legally permissible, whatever the law says you can do or what it fails to tell you that you can't do. Those are the things that are permissible. But then in this other circle, you've got everything that's morally permissible. So all the things that morality says that you are allowed to do, and anything that falls outside the circle is whatever is immoral. And so now you can see that with there, you know, being place of non-overlap, where these circles don't line up exactly, you can come up with examples of something that's legal but immoral. For example, any law that allows ethnic cleansing would be something that would allow immoral actions, but they're still illegal. In Nazi Germany, it was illegal to get rid of people on the basis of their ethnicity. And they thought of it in terms of cleaning vermin. So ethnic cleansing is immoral, but it was legal. Similarly, I don't know of any society that makes it illegal for you to lie to your friends in a way that's hurtful. There are going to be some cases like perjury in the court where that's illegal, but if you lie to your friend on the street, if you are hanging out and you just fudged the truth and you know that it was wrong to do so, there aren't any laws against that. You just did something that was wrong. And so even if we say, for the one, ethnic cleansing should have been illegal, we're not automatically thinking that is also true for whether there should be laws about preventing you from lying to your friends or your friends lying to you. You might say the law shouldn't talk about that. But on the other hand, you can also think of laws that prohibit free exercise of religion. There are plenty of countries that require a specific religion to be obeyed, and that's historically recent that that wasn't the case for most countries. Now, whatever you think about religion, a law that prohibits the free exercise of religion is making something that should be legal illegal, because it's morally permissible for people to exercise their religion. Now, I realize that it sounds like I'm being just a Western thinker, somebody product of European thought, but there is a fact of the matter, whether legality and morality align or don't align on specifically this point. If you also think of similar cases where the ability to have free speech is infringed. We're basically saying, whereas it would be morally permissible for you to speak freely, we can have a law that says you're not allowed to speak. And there are plenty of countries where freedom of speech is not important to them. They don't care about your human rights. Now, so these are supposed to be things that are morally permissible, but some countries make them illegal. And this is all we're trying to show with the legal moral distinction, is that legality is not morality and vice versa. Even though there is a huge overlap in the middle of whatever's legal is also moral. We want to be able to distinguish when they're not. Now, Rawls' theory of justice, since he's talking about social contract theory, he's trying to come up with a view that looks something like this, that morality just is whatever free, rational, equal contractors would agree to live by. So if you want to know what something's whether something's morally right or wrong, you don't consult your laws. Instead, you imagine what would somebody who had complete control to set up a good society, what would they make the laws to be? And given that they have to make agreements with other people, what kinds of things would they say, this is a freedom that I should not have in order that we have a better life together? How can we best cooperate? So whatever those contractors, those people who make laws that would be under the best conditions, what kind of laws would they make? So these are ideal contractors in that they're free. They have all these freedoms. They're rational. They have information. They're thinking through their decisions deliberatively, and they're equal. Nobody has power or influence over the others. They all have their fair share in saying how society will be governed. So what would they make these laws to be? Now, this sounds like it would be a little bit abstract, but you can kind of think, well, would we permit murder? No. Would we permit somebody to kill, like, where there's a high risk of, being caught? No. There's a lot of different things that are just obvious that we would think is immoral, and that's precisely what these ideal contractors would say, we should have a law against it. Now, ideal contractors would only agree to create laws that preserve a good balance of freedom and equality that also promotes fairness for everyone. And this is going to be like Rawls' simple phrase that justice is fairness. If you want to know what is just, it has to do with fairness. And so if we could pick laws that apply to us no matter where we end up in society, then it applies to me just as much as it applies to you, and that's fair. And that's what makes the society just. We would pick laws or we would pick agreements that would put us in a position that's worth living. We would want to live in that society when it's all said and done, no matter where we end up, whether we're rich or poor or whatever race we are. That would be the ideal society, is that you would agree to those laws. Now, this has a lot of wiggle room because there's going to be a lot of differences that people have. Not everybody agrees on a ton of things. Should everyone have the same goods and property? No, not everybody wants the same stuff. Not everybody finds the same things valuable in life. So if we want different things, that's fine. We'll respect our differences. We don't have to require everyone has the same property, and we're not going to require everyone has the same goods. Likewise, does everybody have the same interests, what they want to do in life, what they find valuable or worthwhile in pursuing in life? The answer's no. Does everybody have the same goals? No. And so we can respect differences, and whatever ideal contractors would be kind of making as good laws, then these kinds of differences would be protected too, so that we can be different and still be able to operate in society without being under one or the other person's just automatic benefit because the contractors favor one kind of goal over another. No, they're not going to. And because they're ideal. They're not going to because they have everything kind of like sorted in their minds.